Hello, everyone, and welcome to this hour and a half we have to talk to a phenomenal number of guests. So if you're watching us on the TVs around the place, we are very, very happy to be with you at ICT Spring 2023, 10 years of ICT Spring, actually. And this is day two, of course. Now, as you can see, I have got four people with me. Barbara Bavé, you are from PMB Paribas. Laurent Marchini, Société Générale. Jean-Pierre Schmidt, you are from GEMIC. And Raoul Mulheims, you are Phenology, who is just à côté de nous maintenant, right next to us. Now, we're here to talk about the mixture of banks and also the integration of fintech. It's been a very fast-changing environment. I might actually start with you, Raoul, because you came from the fintech side and you have been working with banks. So how have you seen that develop over the last decade?
Yeah, actually, we started out, and thank you for the question. Actually, we started out in 2011, I think, roughly, was the first meeting at the time with the State and Savings Bank. And that became afterwards, actually, this project when we started it as a pilot project into the DigiCash application, later turned into the Payconiq application. So, and the term fintech was actually coined, I think, in 2014 and 15, and we were pretty happy about that because finally we had a specific term that would kind of qualify also the business segment we were in. So, evolution, I think there's one main evolution that has also had a huge influence on how fintech is perceived today. In the beginning, we had this kind of opposition between, and it was also cultivated, let's say, also by media, but also by the players themselves, this opposition between old generation and new generation players. And that has turned into something where, well, welcome to reality today. And there, I think there's another kind of line between the two players, which is, well, not the two kind of players, but another line actually has been drawn. Which is on one side B2B services and on the other side the B2C services, where also the partnerships and the setups highly differ and they have become way closer actually, and today you can't really say there's a kind of opposition between the different kind of players.
So much more collaboration and one needs the other very much as well. Actually, I want to turn to you, Jean-Pierre, to tell us what GEMIC is in the first instance.
We would qualify ourselves as a product-centered service company. We have a couple of products that are very important for banks, be it in client communication or securing web and mobile applications that are existing within the bank. But these products alone, they are very helpful, but our specialty is also to make them really work inside the bank and to go the extra mile. So I often say we do not only go the extra mile, we go twice around the globe for you, because we really try to take care of everything and make sure that it really works and overcome any barrier together with the bank, be it internal barriers, with partners, compensating for a lot of things. And this is what our clients love about us. It's that we really get things done in a way that it works afterwards.
Mm-hmm. And then turning to the bank side, Barbara, perhaps you can start to tell us about your point of view, how banks have worked with fintech, financial technology companies, small, medium size, and integrated that either from the outside in or even in-house.
All right. So from a bank perspective, I think that fintechs are an opportunity for us, because we're working with very, very old system, very, very old technologies, while fintechs, well, they have the latest languages and the way they are doing is quite doing as with parameters. So here in the bank, in BGL BNP Paribas, what we did, which is a very success story, to be honest. At the very first, they told us, you are crazy to do that. But yes, we did outsource our KYC services from an administration point of view. And each bank actually is driven by the same laws. And we have one actor which is doing the job for all, because at the end of the day, we are serving our clients. So for us, it's really an opportunity to work with fintechs.
And you chose to outsource to get the latest innovation, to have a different mindset. And now, do you still outsource, or do you also have your own R&D department in-house?
Actually, we are outsourcing. We are outsourcing what I would say is common to each financial actors here in Luxembourg, but it could be also outside Luxembourg, that is to say the identification of our clients. When you say that, it's about identity, it's about tax issues. Of course, within the bank, we keep the decision as well as all some other features regarding the KYC, but I mean, this is prop and owned by the bank in terms of what we have to do in terms of due deal. Mm-hmm. So for an example, we are not outsourcing the MiFi profile.
Yeah.
That's an example.
And I want to turn to you, really similar idea, but from a different bank's point of view, Laurent. Société Générale, have you done a similar thing to Barbara, or has it been more in-house development?
So I would say it's quite the same, because it's also for us an opportunity. So we have launched different incubator of startups. So we work, and we used to work with different startups. We have also done, I think like you, a lot of acquisition in terms of startup. I believe that at the group level, we have made around 10 acquisitions of startups. So I believe that it's very important, because in terms of time to market, we cannot do everything alone in the future. In terms of competencies, when you are talking, for example, about digital assets, cyber security, you have the competencies sometimes outside the bank. So we definitely need to partner with startups to acquire competency and to better serve the client, because they can do faster with the startups. So definitely, yes.
But you could also think about buying in the startups, buying them up and integrating them inside the banks.
Yes, definitely, yes. It's part of the strategy. So it's buying the startups, so acquisition or partnering with the startup.
Mm-hmm. And then I want to talk about the role of ABBL. For those who are outside of Luxembourg, firstly explain what ABBL is and its role.
Yeah, definitely. So ABBL is the Association des Banques et Banquiers Luxembourgeois, so dedicated to... So we have an innovation, fintech and innovation forum dedicated to foster the collaboration between traditional banks. So we have more than 143 banks, I think, in Luxembourg, with the startups and fintech in Luxembourg and outside Luxembourg. Our purpose is mainly to foster the collaboration, because, you know, Luxembourg is a financial place, and now with innovation, it's going faster. And if you are not embracing innovation, tomorrow we are potentially at risk in Luxembourg. So the purpose of our group is definitely to foster innovation, to foster collaboration, the advocacy, also a lot of education and training. We have a lot of pitch of startups, but also another goal is also to increase initiatives at the level of the industry to be there tomorrow. It's a question of future.
And Barbara, for you, ABBL, are there conversations with inside ABBL thinking about what are the next strategies that are required to help buoy up the and continue that leading position of Luxembourg in the finance market?
I definitely think that ABBL has a role to play, has a role to get everybody together and see what can be mutualized in terms of services. And to do that, of course, you will need to partner with some startups, whether they're being a regulatory startup or fintech. So it has really a role to play there.
I'm going to turn to the entrepreneurs here now. When you're thinking about your ideas and what would work from an entrepreneurial point of view, where do you get your ideas? Where do they come from? Are you in conversation with more the clients, the customers? Are you working with the banks, or do they come to you first of all? Raoul?
Well, I mean, it's the key success factor there is actually to observe what is going to happen on the market. And I think also one key driver there is regulation. So it's not a topic that is, let's say, the most liked or the most sexy also for the players in the financial industry, because if it is perceived generally as hindering evolution at certain levels. But we also got counterexamples there, like PSD, Payment Service Directive, back in 2009 when it was put into Luxembourg law, that triggered a huge wave of innovation actually coming from there. PSD2, mitigated success, let's say. So at various levels, there has been evolutions, but not necessarily. But we also saw, and that is, okay, I have to say this in this perspective, because we're serving almost exclusively players, regulated entities in the financial industry also, with the different product lines that we do have. Regulation is a key drive for our product evolution. So our job is actually also to observe what is about to come, also at EU level or national level, where is there and I'm taking this up for what Barbara and Ron was saying, so about mutualization that doesn't have necessarily to be an effort that is driven necessarily by all the stakeholders together, but it's kind of also as entrepreneurs, when we build these products, it's a mutualization product, because that's the essence, that's actually what makes it successful also from a business perspective for us, is if we can see, okay, is it there at least like 10 clients that are going to use this product? So mutualization is at the heart of every business idea also, like we build it with Finology.
Yeah, same to you, John. Oh, yeah.
I would also jump on this. The first thing is the reading of reality, and this is done with conversations. So as we are working with banks since 14 years, we are in conversations with banks. We see the issues that they are, and we listen. But sometimes then there comes a problem statement that says, oh, I want to communicate securely with emails to my customers. We say, aha, interesting. But maybe let's reformulate this problem statement, and let's say, okay, you want to create more engagement points with your clients. You want to have a more fluent and automated way of exchanging communication, and maybe the solution is not a secured email, but an instant messenger that is automated and that is tightly integrated into your tools. And then we're innovating together, so co-creating this product. And then a very, very important element also in the collaboration between fintechs and banks, if I may, I often compare it to getting fit. You can have the best personal trainer, the best coach, the biggest abonnement to a gym, but if you have not the willingness to get fit and do the effort to get fit, then you will never get fit. And same is with innovation. You can have the best fintechs accompanying you, and you can make beautiful slides and statements, but if you have not the willingness really to innovate and change and be agile, then it will not happen. And this is essential for the cooperation between a fintech and the bank.
Well, you've given us a wonderful analogy there. I've never heard that analogy before, and it now sits in my mind. But as you're talking and you're speaking very eloquently about the personalization necessary in our modern banking world, where we all have everything on these phones, and I can personally see, because I belong to a few different banks, I can see what's good and what's bad between them, as I'm sure you can as well. And it really matters as a customer. So I suppose, apart from just the collaboration between fintech companies and the banks, and regulation, of course, maybe it's more of a diamond shape. You've got the regulation, the fintech, the banks, and you've got the customer. So how important is that personalization these days for you when you're thinking about how to proceed into the future services?
Okay, I will start first. The client is always at the center of our attention. So we are value-driven. Value we can bring to the client. And of course, alone, I don't think we can manage everything. So we need to rely on other actors in order to serve the client. But at the end of the day, it's the client. If we develop a product that has no value for the client, it will never work. So we need really to work together. And I think that for me, regulation is helping as well in forcing us working all together. And of course, we are here in ICT event. You will know that for banks, ICT issues, risk issues, IT risk is really a key component. So whenever we're discussing with fintechs, we always need to make sure that they are aware about what they do with the data to make sure integrity, confidentiality, and the way that things are transferred is always a priority for them.
And for a final comment, anyone want to come in? Make it a strong one.
No, for me, I can be agree with you. Client is king. Regulation is needed. The purpose of regulation aims to protect the investor. It aims to make the financial stability. So it's not a question. We need to be regulated. We are regulated, and we need to ensure that the startups who are going to work in the future, they are in the same page. So for me, it's also a question of alignment in terms of strategy, in terms of culture. It's like a wedding. If you want that your wedding is successful, you need to have an alignment. So it's quite the same.
You mean the marriage, not the wedding, I think.
Marriage.
The marriage ought to last longer than the wedding, sometimes. On that happy note, thank you so much, Laurent. I hope your legs recover after your mountain climbing episodes. And thank you so much, Barbara, Raoul, Jean-Pierre. A pleasure to have you all with me to start this show. Thank you, and continue to enjoy the conference. Thank you all. Thank you.